Welcome to another episode of Silk and Steel Podcast.
I'm your host, Carl Zab. Today we have very special guests from all the way from Taiwan, Mr. Lin Wei. How should I introduce you, Mr. Lin Wei?
You could just call me Lin Wei or anything you want. Yeah, I come from Keelung, Taiwan, and I am an organizer of a hip-hop association.
Yes, so today we have Lin Wei and also people already familiar with him, Mr. Xiangyu. So both of you are rappers of Taiwanese background who have been participating in the Taiwanese hip-hop culture from very beginning. So we wanted to talk about today's evolution of hip-hop and how it got transformed into American urban culture into part of the Chinese, music scene, and how the Chinese hip hop got evolved. We have done previously a Chinese recording of this. Now we're gonna do it in English for my English audience. So again, welcome to the show, Mr. Lin, and welcome back to the show, Xiangyu.
Good to be back as always.
Okay, I'm pretty stoked talking about the Chinese hip hop. I'm pretty sure there's also a lot of interest among my audience, but I am more of a student, so I'm gonna shut up and let you guys talk because you guys are the actual players. So who wants to take it over, Xiangyu or Mr. Lin?
Let me just start introducing what I was talking about when I was working on my thesis in my organization, right? Yeah. Most people that talking about hip hop culture that describe this as an amazing or like a miracle that comes from subculture of the minority in the United States and become popular to the world, What I was thinking was that those encouraging stories stood behind the ideology of supporting the cultural industry expanding over other countries. What I'm concerned about is not merely focusing on how these art forms are connected or influenced public taste, but on the text of political economics and social facts. So, I was trying to emphasize rap music and dances, which are easily controlled by the international corporations of the cultural industry. To start with that, as Toby Miller mentioned while explaining the entertainment services industry of the United States, the African American market was discovered during the trends of disco in the 1970s. And the anxiety popped out within not only the community of white Americans, but also the community of African Americans due to the right of discourse. Right of discourse was taken by the huge commercial interest, and this description caught my attention to understand the situation of hip hop culture in Taiwan or in the United States. Yeah,
I want to interject for a second. So actually, the mainstream appropriation of the Black culture, especially in the music scene, this has been going on all the way since beginning of the United States, right? I mean, they start with jazz, right? And then later, rock and roll, right? It was only when Elvis Presley, a white guy, popularized it, and then that became acceptable for the mainstream white culture to accept it. And by now, rock and roll is so whitewashed that people look at rock and roll, they don't even realize of its African, like the African American roots. You know, they think rock and roll, they think all these white rockers, right? I think hip hop is both the latest iteration of that, of the mainstream adoption and appropriation of Black culture, but it's also an exception because the hip hop today, even with white rappers like NMN, it's still very much associated with the Black culture, yeah, sure. Unlike, say, rock and roll, right? So there's several layers of nuances. But okay, so that's my end of my interjection, handing the mic back to you, Mr. Lin, because Mr. Lin actually wrote a thesis, right? Like a term paper on this whole history.
Right? Yeah, I wrote a whole paper, and yeah. And the topic I was talking about was the process of industrialization and globalization of hip hop culture, and most people say that hip hop started in the 1970s, right? Yeah, but before this, hip hop was a kind of gathering party in the hood, reducing the conflicts within the communities and gangs in the ghetto hood, and there was no official published hip hop or rap album until 1979. After 1979, the hip hop culture or rap music start to get involved in the entertainment industry, in the music industry, and in the following 1980s. The amount of investment from the corporations increased. And for example, the Beastie Boys in the 1982 and the establishment of Def Jam Records in 1984 and the first endorsement Run-DMC received from the sport brand Adidas. And moreover, in 1986, the godfather of hip hop, which name is Afrika Bambaataa, involved in the producing and publishing of rap album, and also the first female rap group Salt and Pepper emerged, and DJ Kumo did that, and that is all the story about the 1980s, and the industry of hip hop sprouts in this decade, In this 10 years of 1980s, we could see that a lot of different styles of hip hop or Black culture sprout around the United States and start its global journey. And the increasing investment that flew into this community-oriented artist and changed their living conditions seems to be positive. But we should be aware that the purpose of this corporation is mainly profit, though we do not have to take this as certain extreme nationalist or conspiracy theorist that those white people were meant to steal the fruits of the minorities. The voices selected by the capitalist must correspond to the values and ideology for maintaining their interest. And that's the beginning of my stories.
I think a common theme of this discussion today is there seems to be this sort of idealist understanding of culture in general, where people just kind of ignore the role that capital plays, because the reality is, in a capitalist society, the bourgeoisie will try to influence culture. So grassroots art forms, and wherever there's people, there's going to be art, you know. And then and with hip hop, you know, it began as a grassroots art form, mainly by impoverished African Americans. But the thing is, no matter what culture emerges in a capitalist society, as soon as it proves to be profitable, the capitalists will swoop in and try to kind of control it through various means. So, you know, because that's why, you know, in the 1990s, we'll get into it later, you see the buying up of a lot of the small and medium record labels, and then the systematic toning down of a lot of the more conscious-oriented hip-hop, you know. That's going to be it.
I call this, there's a Disney version of the history of hip-hop. Right, which is what being spread among most people. And then there's a real history of hip hop, which is what we're trying to give to our audience here. And as Xiangyu mentioned, anything that has potential to make money will be commodified in a capitalist society. And this happened to hip hop. This happened before with, you know, African American music and culture, like jazz before that, and rock and roll before that. This is just the latest manifestation. And Xiangyu, you brought up about the point that, you know, hip hop itself came from the street. It originally contained a lot of content about the struggles within the African American community. There's a lot of political message. There's a lot of a progressive message. But as the content and the media get increasingly commercialized, the political message are starting to get drowned out by more mundane and, you know, more hedonistic messages. Like you know, there's critiques of that within U.S. you know, as well. I remember Keenan Peele comedy sketch. You know, there was one where the guy started out rapping about the struggle, about the community, about solidarity, and then the other guy jumps out and go talk about the pussy, getting the money, and it's funny, but it's also true. That has been the evolution of hip hop in the last few decades. But Mr. Lin, walk us through that.
Before we get into that, I just want to mention that this is going to be covered later, but it's kind of a double-edged sword. Like when I talked about the whole metaphysical and idealistic understanding of hip hop, saying, oh, it started from the streets and then it grew and then it was a movement and then it became worldwide just kind of on its own. That's not really how it happened. I mean, I'm not trying to say downplay the efforts of the pioneers and all they've done for this culture, but the fact of the matter is, it became international at the scale it is today because of its commercialization and because of U.S. as its global position as the sole hegemony. So whatever makes it big in the U.S., it'll become a cultural commodity to the rest of the world. You can be some kid in, I don't know, in Bangkok, and you're going to turn on the TV, MTV, and you're going to see the latest popular music in America. And what happens is, yes, a lot of, for lack of a better term, the hip hop as a whole, or any culture in general, becomes gentrified to a certain extent. But then what happens is this gentrified, commodified version of the art becomes global due to imperialism. And then you have people from all over the world who like the sound. And then they're, in a way, they kind of de-gentrify it as it goes back to the grassroots. So that's it's kind of, there's this sort of understanding among certain people in the U.S. who aren't too aware of these intricacies, who just think, oh, anyone who is not black who does hip hop, regardless of where they are in the world, is just cultural appropriation. And I think this is a very one-dimensional way of looking at the problem. This is not saying that issues like cultural appropriation don't exist. No, they certainly do, but it doesn't explain everything, all of the phenomena that we're seeing.
That's basically looking at this global history of hip hop from a very US-centric lens, because appropriation does happen in US, but what happens as it spreads outside the US border, something else happens, and a lot of times this, yes, but it's propelled, the globalization is propelled by the U.S. hegemony, the U.S. soft power, and then it made easily digestible for the other youth around the world to accept it, and then maybe try to copy and create it as their own. And so this is like a little preview of what we're going to talk about. This is kind of the outline. We're going to go into the nitty-gritty. So that's Mr. Lin Wei is going to walk us through that, right? Mr. Lin?
Yeah, yeah.
And I apologize. I apologize for Yiti because I was... I did a 2 hours podcast just prior to this recording. I haven't eaten my breakfast since I woke up, and I'm starving. So I apologize if people see me eating while Lin Wei is talking about the history of hip hop. I meant no respect. I just need to feed myself. So Go ahead, Mr. Lin.
Yeah, and during the '90s, that the capitals, the corporations see a lot of profits in this culture or this community. So they started to buy all this independent records in the United States, and lots of different voices started to disappear. With this numerous profit, the capitals investing in the hip hop industry increased. Most artists and their companies were merged into corporations, and some voices were silenced in this game. This cannot be denied that the 1990s was the great developing era of hip hop culture, with lots of different styles and skills. But the name of Golden Age might only be accepted by those artists admired by the capitalist and those lovers of the art forms. And if we stand in the perspectives of the community of the minorities or the third world countries, the Golden Age would mean different than what hip-hop lovers used to think. That means that the hip-hop culture delivered by the international corporations began its journey of globalization and industrialization in this 10 years, in the 1990s. Yeah, and during the periods of the Cold War, the United States gradually acquires its international dominant position in politics, economies, and ideology through international associations and cooperation in the enactment of laws in intellectual property rights. And other than the Hollywood movies, other cultural products and industry also spread internationally through this process and build their own chains of new international division of cultural labors. And that's what Toby Miller talked about. And the package of hip-hop cultures that's selected by the international corporations was shipped to the world. So that is the most common aspect of, for most people outside the United States knows about hip-hop. And that's what I received when I was a juvenile. And meanwhile,
I like to put a little personal anecdote in here. Yeah. I know you guys are like the pioneers of among the pioneers of the hip hop culture in Taiwan.
No. Pioneers are before us. We're like second, third gen.
Second generation. You're like the second generation.
Yeah.
But I was in United States in 90s when they just starting to gain mainstream acceptance, especially early 90s. I remember in 1992, I went to a Chicago public school in Southside Chicago, which is 90% black, right? And we would have our classmates, they would do like rap battles during recession. But it was still very spontaneous back then. It was like just people showing off and it was just something like fun to do. But that was also around just a couple years later, I noticed rap itself as an art form started to gain more mainstream audience because more white teenagers are starting to listen to rap music. And even at that time, there were even like people making derogatory words for these white kids listening to rap.
Sounds like the name of the minority in Xinjiang.
Yeah, it sounds like how white people will pronounce the name of Uyghur, right? They will say Uyghur. But that was a name actually surfaced in 1990s. Referred to these new white suburban kids who are just catching on to the popularity of rap music. Yeah, that's my little historical flashback. Please continue.
Yeah. Some people might say that white hip hop could be so popular by to those white kids. It is because that a lot of rap music or rap lyrics that talks about the experiences or the environments or the communities that those white kids will never imagine or will never, could never get into. And that's something.
That's a great point. That's a great point. There was even a Beavis and Butthead episode when Beavis told Butthead, you know, you're not born, you're not from Compton, you'll never make it to go away to Compton. that's exactly what you're talking about there. Yeah.
Some people's research about how hip hop become popular products that is part of the reasons. And yeah. But that might not be what I concerned the most. And and beside the capital roots of hip hop, those actors related to the Universal Zulu Nation, which was established by the pioneer Afrika Bambaataa. This organization continued to deliver their weight of hip hop practices, which is community services and to unite or the minorities or minority groups. So they continue to deliver their weight of hip hop practices. So that makes the hip hop culture that spread around the world became two different roles. And those two different roles of hip hop led the world to see the at least two aspects of hip hop. One is the capitalist stereotype of minorities, and the other side is the hard workers seeking changes for the communities. And yeah, that's the difference. And in the concept of Tomlinson's work, who wrote the book of Cultural Imperialism, though we should not take we should not stand skin deeply with conservationists against cultural imperialism, still we could not neglect the danger of reactionary and ideology that the international corporations, cultural industry, and commercialization carries. And such as Bell,
Sorry to interject again. That actually reminded me of that Key and Peele episode. Even though you criticize the phenomena of like the dumbing down of the political message in hip hop, it went to all talking about the pussies and the money and the power. They don't really actually talk about the root cause, why that happens, why that transition happens. But if you actually put it inside the framework of how the multinational corporations commodified what was previously a street culture, African American culture, and packaged it and tried to sell it as a product around the world, then it makes sense because the corporations they don't really care about the struggle. They don't want to care about the political message of overthrowing capitalism.
They kind of don't want people all over the world to hear things like I don't know, like I'm glad Reagan's dead.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, it's there, but you have to dig for it. So it's a double-edged sword. I think on what Lin Wei was trying to say earlier is, you know, imperialism is real, and we cannot ignore the negative effects. But we should realize that they're also the imperialists with their imperialism are also burying their own graves because they're connecting people who otherwise would have never been connected before. Not just and not just linguistically, but like culturally. Now you have like kids from all over the world, and maybe traditionally their nations hated each other, but now you have these kids who have certain things in common. It's like, hey, I like Jay-Z, you like Jay-Z. I like McDonald's, you like McDonald's. Maybe we have more in common than we previously thought. Let's
I think Taiwan is a can be a case study of how hip hop spread as a cultural package of American soft power and cultural hegemony to the rest of the world. But then it's been localized and adopted by the local youth to express their own feelings and their own standing and their own thoughts about the society. I think Taiwan happened in Taiwan. Also, you know, Taiwan, I think, is one of the first Chinese language speaking places that took to the hip hop culture is also because Taiwan is part of the U.S. imperial system, right? You know, Taiwan is basically a client state of United States, so it's a lot more exposed to the cultural export of U.S. And both of you are more intimately familiar with this part of the history, especially how the hip hop took roots in Taiwan. So let's talk about that. Go ahead, Mister.
Like Carl said, the Taiwan's proximity to empire has a little side effect because ever since the mainland opened up, you know, Taiwan and Hong Kong have become like this sort of gateway to Western culture in many cases, especially localized forms of it, just because of its proximity to the imperial court in comparison to the mainland.
Yes, yeah. Because it's I remember a lot of the mainland kids were probably experimenting with hip hop on their own. But when the hip hop inspired, you know, rap lyrics get popularized in mainland, is when all these Taiwanese or the overseas Chinese singers started to incorporate rap in their own music. And I noticed that maybe around 2000, you say, maybe?
Around then, yes.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead, sorry. No.
Yeah, I think a lot of people knows what happens in the United States, and let's talk about Taiwan. Yeah, as we all know that after 1949, the government of the Republic of China escaped to Taiwan due to the loss of the Civil War, and Taiwan became a front line of the global capitalist camp against the communist countries such as China and the USSR. And the government found aid from the United States to support the industrial development in Taiwan and enter the era of import substitution industrialization. And soon after the 1960s, the tension of numerous civil rights movement in the United States, the global capitalist crisis and reinforced Cold War situation occurred. The problem of low productivities, insufficient funds, and lack of domestic demands in Taiwan urged the government to transform the industry to export-oriented industrialization and to attract the developed countries to further investment with low price and docile labors. And in this period of time, Taiwan was officially enrolled in the global industrial chain. And in the process of globalization, the division of labor includes not only industrial production but also a cultural commodity. And since 1980s, the United States began to establish the Telecommunication Act and intellectual property rights internationally in numerous arguments with other countries, and to ensure its dominant position in global cultural markets. Taiwanese government, as a member of capitalist camp, corresponded to this trend and did for constructing a better environment for investment as the government reformed the law of trademark and patent. Furthermore, reorganized the related bureaus in 1999. From this perspective of cultural labors and international division of cultural labors, all these political processes make the United States more convenience to deliver their ideology and expand the markets and cultivate skilled cultural labors. Before the conference in intellectual property rights between Taiwan and the United States in 1987, a lot of illegal cultural products like CDs or DVDs selling all around the Taiwan's like night markets or even in the record stores, and Taiwan
even
was
in the 90s until the early 2000s, it wasn't really enforced that seriously until after 2000, to be perfectly honest.
Yeah.
And this happened all over Asia, not just Taiwan. You know, in Hong Kong, in mainland China, in Vietnam, Thailand, Indonesia, everywhere.
And Taiwan was called Pirate Kingdom in the 90s. And although the lower prices of pirate products might not profit the original company directly, but it also spread the trend. We could buy the same products at a lower price to of a city comes from the United States or rappers or something like that. And yeah, so most of the pioneer hip hop dancers mentioned that all the information about hip hop they had that time in Taiwan was either from the television or from the pirate tapes. And it is the special and transformed roads of cultural products for undeveloped or low wage area. So that's the situation might similar might be familiar to all the area to all the countries around Asia. Although the culture of dancing in pub might be illegal, but for your information that before 1987, Taiwan was under the military law,
Martial law.
martial law. So the dancing and the culture of dancing or pub was not was
Highly
illegal.
regulated.
But in that time that a lot of United States military stationed in Taiwan. So, and American Forces Network radio station introduced various American culture in that time. So, even that Taiwanese people was living in martial law era in that time, we could still receive a lot of information from the United States through these radio stations. The government of Taiwan could not block or control those information from this radio station. People in Taiwan could still easily get the cultural product, any kind of cultural product or cultural styles or any art form from the United States. So,
That's a
and
very
also,
important point, because actually U.S. military acted as a spearhead of American soft power and cultural hegemony in much of East Asia. It started with U.S. occupation of Japan and then later Korea during the Korean War, and then during the Vietnam War. Of course, after Korean War, U.S. starts to station its military in Taiwan. Taiwan just become one of the many U.S. host of military bases in East Asia. And the American GI brought their, American brand American culture to places like to South Vietnam, to Thailand, because during the Vietnam War, the American GI from Vietnam, they would do their R&R in places like Hong Kong, Thailand, and Taiwan, right? And all the services that grew up around the American military kind of start to osmosis into the local population, right? And that's the process you're talking about. Okay, go ahead.
Another fun fact, how Lin talked about the Armed Forces Network Taiwan, the US military radio station? As you know, the US and the so-called ROC government in Taipei broke ties in 1979. So what happened then was that radio station was reorganized and it exists to this day. It's called ICRT or International Community Radio Taipei. And Carl, one of our good friends, Brian, is a regular on that radio station. Says a lot about his politics.
Okay. Yeah, I would not be surprised because he's basically the American expat adjacent, I say in Taiwan. He hangs out with all the American expats and he works at a NED funded news organization, so.
No, the news organization isn't NED funded, but he used to work at a democracy foundation that is NED adjacent. But New Bloom might as well be NED funded. They're pretty much doing their work for free.
Yeah, which is even worse.
Yeah. So although those pub or clubs or nightclubs were banned under the martial law era, but those services spaces like pub nightclubs or Western restaurant bars were still open for the United States.
I think what Lin Wei is trying to say is the governments of Chiang Kai-shek and Jiang Jingguo, his son, tried to preserve like a semblance of, you know, like cultural sovereignty. You know, they wanted to instill this sort of Chinese identity among the people of Taiwan, but the U.S. forces were too powerful. So even no matter what they did, I mean, they did things like ban hippie culture, but at the end of the day, it wasn't very successful.
Oh, yeah. I remember seeing photos of that time, you know, coming out from Taiwan or from even South Vietnam, you know, and everybody was wearing like bell buttons and then like have haircut like mine, you know, like and then, you know, like the total kind of globalization of fashion trend and culture around that time. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, and a lot of musician pioneers that living around this, they earn a lot of money in the clubs or the pubs for the U.S. military at that time. So you could say that the music industry in Taiwan was built around the American cultures. And after the end of martial law era, the Taiwanese government realized that we need a new governance other than disciplines. So they started with legalized this kind of cultural products and services. So a lot of dancers and musicians that sprout under the United States and spread of cultural products arose the awareness of the ideological state apparatus.
Ideological state apparatus.
For example, censorships in artworks. Despite the severe censorship for local artists, imported products were loosely controlled, which became an outlet for people who love arts to fantasize.
But can I add another point? You have to think about the class nature of the people who are able to appreciate foreign stuff, because there is a linguistic barrier and a cultural barrier.
Yeah.
So there's this sort of effect where the people who are first exposed to that are kind of, you know, petty bourgeois, like from the middle classes, they get exposed to it. And then like that culture goes through them first before it like kind of trickles down to the rest of Taiwanese society.
Mm-hmm.
And that happens to hip hop as well.
It definitely started as an urban a trend among the urban youth. I mean, like if you live out in like the rural Taiwan, you're probably not the first to, you know, to consume the hip hop. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so that makes me think about that. The beginning of Taiwan's music industry was controlled by those higher classes people. Those people in higher social classes or with more cultural capitals. Yeah. So back to hip hop. Yeah, a lot of hip hop pioneer dancers were also incorporated with the music industry and started to appear in some TV shows and TV programs published by the official television company.
But at this time, I'm sorry to interject, but in the beginning, it was mostly people doing it as personal hobby, right? Like these urban youth who are just trying out new things. It wasn't, it hasn't been yet caught the attention of music industry in the beginning, right? I mean, in the beginning, it's more grassroots. It's people playing music, experimenting. They're trying to learn the style because they think it's cool. They saw it on television, and it's only there's a process of that shift from the grassroots and then the co-optation by the music industry, right?
Yes.
Yeah. That was kind of like in the very beginning in the 80s that the Taiwanese music industry started to grow, and but those actors in music industry were somewhat with higher social class or cultural capitals, and they start to build up the music industry, and those pioneer dancers were trying to find their way to earn some money with their hobby. So they are in a different situation. That the music industry was more mature in that time, but those hip hop pioneers in Taiwan was like they're just trying to grow. That they are just in their baby times or something. Yeah. So it's like different step or different periods of development. So it's like
my understanding is that, you know, as the Taiwan's economy start to grow, you know, Taiwan start entering into the economic takeoff phase, then the Taiwan cultural industry start to develop. By the time, by the 80s, Taiwan's music industry is already at a pretty mature level, right? Taiwan already has its own indigenous cultural music industry. So the thing about the Taiwan music industry, as Lin mentioned, it was an outgrowth of the U.S. military occupation. But by 1979, there's a sharp break in relation between Taiwan and United States, because after the Nixon visited China in 1972, U.S. start gradually moving to formalization of ties with mainland China, with People's Republic of China. So in 1979, a couple of things happened. First, United Nations kicked out...
No, United Nations was early in 1971.
Oh, really? Oh, shit. I didn't know.
The U.S. was 1979.
Yeah. So, that's probably more important for Taiwan is in 1979, under Jimmy Carter's administration, United States formally broke tie with the so-called Republic of China regime on Taiwan and recognized People's Republic of China as the sole legitimate government of China. And that caused a big shock in Taiwan, you know, because up to this time, ideologically, Taiwan had presented itself as the free China, right? A kind of the bastion of what Chineseness is. The communists, they brought in a foreign ideology. They're doing all the cultural destructions on the mainland, you know, with the Cultural Revolution and all that. But now that with the U.S. switching diplomatic relations.
Before it was China is forever, but the communists are momentary.
Yes. and now when the communist regime, in their eyes, got legitimized, right, by Taiwan's biggest patron and supporter, United States, and there was a feeling of betrayal and also a feeling of, you know, it's like Taiwan betrayed, but people responded to that feeling of betrayal by asserting
their Chineseness
by claiming that they are the true inheritors of the Chinese civilization, of the Chinese culture, unlike those communist Chinese from across the Taiwan Strait. And so there's a kind of reinvigoration of Chinese folk song inspired pop music. Is that close enough for the Xiaoyuan campus folk song?
Yes. So then the government was kind of in support of this, like to counter like all the foreign influence, because like Lin Wei mentioned earlier, like Chiang Kai-shek's government wanted to maintain its own kind of cultural identity, but there was little that it could do to counter the foreign influence. So then you have like the greater influence of you know, rock and roll becoming more popular and stuff around that time. So then this was like a good I guess foil or like a countermeasure to that. It's you had this reinvigoration of like Chinese culture. So then from in the 70s and 80s, late 70s throughout the 80s, there was like a genre of music that was very popular. It was pop, but it was heavily inspired by Chinese folk music. And funnily enough, this kind of music became really popular in the Chinese mainland after they opened up more to Taiwan. And other things were also happening. If you listen to my Taiwan series, in the 1980s were a very politically turbulent time in Taiwan, where you had like the petty bourgeois opposition to the KMT, and just this feeling of certain segments of the population saying, hey, why are we even playing this whole who was the real China game? We're Taiwanese. Like, let China be China. Let Taiwan be Taiwan. So then you also had this kind of going on. And then there's also like a group of people who kind of are looking to the West for inspiration for, you know, like bourgeois freedom and democracy, that sort of stuff. So then all these forces were at play.
I wanted to just do an honorable mention, you know, like the campus folk song, those folk songs that drew inspiration from Chinese cultural influence and Chinese heritage, and also Chinese nationalism. Actually, later became very popular on mainland as mainland starting to open up.
Separatists in Taiwan hate them now.
Yeah, because one for mainland audience is that this first, you know, up to 1976, 78, 79, most of the song music in China had been ideological influence, right? It's about building socialism, building communism, and now whereas you know, some of the Chinese cultural aspect were even looked down upon as being part of the feudal past, right? It's been criticized, and now when China opened up, oh wow! Like, first of all, it's okay to take pride in the Chinese heritage. And coming especially strong when it's through the music medium, through the music from Taiwan and Hong Kong Chinese communities and overseas Chinese, there's an especially strong feeling of the play on the yearning for the homeland, for the, you know, that really appealed to the mainland Chinese audience. There were a couple of songs that got really popular. One is Long de Chuan Ren, which is
Dong Fang Yo Long.
And this is called the Descendant of the Dragon, right? It's also written under this background of the diplomatic break of United States and Taiwan. But this is emphasizing that we are the descendants of the dragon. We are the Chinese.
One of the lines was, even though I've never seen the Yangtze River with my eyes, I often dream about, you know, like,
yes,
seeing it.
Yes. But that had a lot of appeal for the mainland audience. So Long de Chuan, another one is 我的中国心, but I think 我的中国心 might be composing Hong Kong. I wasn't sure. So 龙的传人 and 我的中国心 became super popular in mainland in China. So at this time, this what's popular in Taiwan became popular on mainland China. But that's kind of the overflowing theme of the Chinese music industry at the time. It's this focus. This folk-inspired pop music that was really popular. The hip-hop is just more like an undercurrent. It's something completely new, completely alien.
The 80s wasn't really hip-hop yet. I think when we're getting the time, I think what we're trying to say is, so the 80s, this was going on, but then that also created a demand for other things because people don't like monotony. And the 80s was also a time when people were looking to the West for different reasons, like, you know, democracy, because Taiwan was still under martial law. So then they looked up to places like the US and the UK, not very good examples, but that's what, you know, when you've been influenced by the US for so long, that's kind of how you think. So then I'd say in the late 80s, especially with the lifting of martial law, everything that came from America, came from the West, just became even more exciting because now it's just like, back then it was like, okay, we got little glimpses through the radio, like the military radio, but now it's just like, hey, it's just out in the open, and foreign record labels and entertainment companies are working with local companies and they're creating like all sorts of stuff. Like I remember in the 1990s when I was little, all this stuff just seemed so fresh, you know?
Yeah.
So there was a sort of displacement of, so in the 80s was, if the 80s were characterized by this like kind of perhaps forced reinvigoration of Chinese culture, the late 80s and the 90s and then on is kind of like the negation of that.
Yeah, the cultural trends always change, right? And the fashion trends, cultural trends, they change very fast. People always chase the next biggest thing, the next hottest thing. Right. And it happens with people's music taste as well. I think hip hop became well placed, I think, to make its appearance on the Taiwan stage, because through this, you know, over dominance of the campus folk song in the 80s, people are ready for change. They're ready for something new, something completely different. Right.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah. Something like that. And yeah. Yeah, what I was trying to say was that although some kind of hip hop culture appears to Taiwan in the 80s, but the situation and environment were not strong enough to provide the hip hop community to grow fast enough in the 80s. But yeah, as you say, that in the late 80s and the early 90s, a lot of Western popular culture products started to be shipped into Taiwan and in this era, in this period of time, especially the MTV channel began broadcasting in 1995, making it easier for the cultural products to be introduced to Chinese people. Yeah, so Taiwan's industry development stepped into the post-industrialization era in the mid-1990s and around mid-90s. And
that coincided with the opening in China, because China at the time was welcoming Taiwanese investment into mainland, welcoming Taiwan capital. So what happened is previously Taiwan functioned as some manufacturing base oriented toward export to the U.S. market, leveraging a cheap and docile workforce, now find even cheaper labor costs on mainland China. So capitalists always chase the highest profit, lowest cost. So of course, they all went to China and relocate their factories to China. So that's why Taiwan went through this period of deindustrialization, right? Because all the factory got moved, got outsourced to mainland China.
Yeah. So in that period of time, the economic growth started to decrease. That makes the situation for the larger scale companies or corporations to gain further control of Taiwanese market, even in the cultural industry. And at the same time, hip hop culture began popularized around the world in the 90s. The most obvious case in Taiwan was like the 1992 published hip hop group LA Boys. The group's LA Boys was initiated the trend with their members wearing hip hop cultures, and they are all American born Chinese accent. And a lot of similar groups that started to pop out in the 90s. The corporation started to find out that it is profitable. This phenomenon demonstrate that the local market of hip hop culture was mature enough to expand or to step into another level.
I also wanted to interject for a second. You know, the under capitalism, you know, the corporations eventually tend to monopoly in the end, right? For the big fish to swallow the small fish to become even bigger fish, and for music industries in Taiwan but also in Hong Kong, they're not just making music for the local audience, but they're also making music for the Chinese diaspora, you know, the Chinese speak language audience across Southeast Asia, you know, and further beyond. And this time the capitalism always looking for new markets, right? they're always looking for new markets to expand to take over, and they are always scouting for what's the next hot up and coming, and it's just hip hop in the 90s is already a proven product within the US, within kind of the English speaking audience, and with the breakout of the Chinese rappers and the Chinese hip hoppers, it shows that it has future in the Chinese speaking audience as well. So of course, and the resource gets directly into that. And okay, I'm gonna shut up now and hand the mic back to you.
Yeah. And actors outside the mainstream, actor outside the cultural industry. Started to prosper as well. For example, the TBC, the Best Group, is the first Taiwanese hip hop dance studio that established in 1996, and one of the pioneer hip hop DJ Chicano stated that he alone with his group started the first grassroots hip hop party in 1997. And tons of activities and dress and styles pop out in the 1990s. Those also attract the attention of not only music lovers but also corporations and politicians. Yeah, in the early 2000s, many hip hop events were held by on the behalves of corporations and KMT. Kuomintang. A lot of hip hop events were held on the behalf of KMT and other corporations. And KMT was the dominant political party at that time. And during this period, due to insufficient resources and information, there were not many critical comments about this situation and for this situation. But yeah, from the late 80s to the early 90s, hip hop developed under the complex cooperation within corporations, political parties, and local youngsters. From the late 90s to early 2000s, the skills and technology and cultural productions developed well enough for Taiwanese styles and business market. With new internet technology, those independent artists could expose themselves in multiple ways nowadays. But back to those days before the internet, the main causes that attracted the pioneers involving into the practice of hip hop were mostly from the image of the mainstream media. Yeah, and in the year of 2000, Magic Stone Records that Moyen Changpian, Magic Stone, signed two underground rappers, MC Hard Dog and Dwaki. Yeah, that announced the successful road into cultural industry for hip hop artists. And after that, underground hip hoppers and those rap stars, they stand together against pop culture. The early songs that MC Hard Dog wrote about, and the so-called underground hip hop grew into a new style.
So it's like a counterculture.
Right? It was. I mean, one of MC Hot Dog's earliest lyrics was to kind of just establish that fuck all this shit. I'm here to like just stir things up. Like one of his lyrics was "Xi Huai fuck, Cai Yilin suck, 这样的音乐 motherfucking bullshit." Xi Huai fuck, Cai Yilin suck, 这样的音乐 motherfucking bullshit. 以你这样的形象，你还能再红几年？金光党做这种音乐在骗钱，就让我来 rap，揭开你的苍白，就让我来 rap，你把听众当白痴啊，就让我来 rap，哈哈，有钱屌就大，就让我来 rap，来开。
It's true though. It's true. Yeah. I'm sorry.
I took offense to the tithing line. I've always had a crush on her when I was a little kid.
Sorry, I'm older than you, so I never got the, you know, the why Tai Yiling was so popular. But yeah, there was a kind of over the dominance, the predominance of the kind of the regular pop culture. Both in Taiwan, but also in China, because by 1980s, when China opened up and a lot of this Taiwanese cultural products made their way into mainland, it was insanely popular because like people are like, holy shit, you can sing stuff about this, before like you can only sing about the party, about the new China. Yeah, boring. Like now, you can sing about like romantic love and all kind of shit. This is great. And so in 1980s, 1990s, I think all the way to 2000, the Taiwanese and also music from Hong Kong, they were super popular in China. Like people of that generation, they can sing you like Taiwanese songs, no problem. Like people of my cousin's generation, they really could.
There was a saying from your childhood, 白天听邓小平，晚上听邓丽君.
Yeah,
we listened to Deng Xiaoping during the day, and at night we listened to Deng Lijun, who was a pop singer from Taiwan.
Yeah, yeah, Teresa then. But that was more my auntie's generation. I was a little small kid back then, I don't know what's good.
好像花儿开在春风里. Okay, sorry.
Make sure you keep your singing in the video, okay? In the final edited
form. Okay.
I can understand. I can understand the counterculture argument of hip hop against because I remember too in 90s and early 2000s. Because my sister would always listen to these whatever is popular from Taiwan, and it's always very syrupy.
Okay, sorry.
I hate those songs, and that's why I kind of get this counter-cultural argument against it. I get why people find a refreshment in hip hop. yeah, I get that. Okay, go ahead, Mr. Lin.
Yeah, the new style challenged the public, but the rap songs imported from the U.S. Mostly were popular, and the lyrics are talking about their money or their jewels or the drugs they had. So, yeah, such as Nelly, Eminem, and Lil Wayne that was so popular in Taiwan that time.
But it wasn't that controversial because of the linguistic barrier. But when Taiwanese rappers tried to emulate that and rap it in Chinese, parents started getting mad.
yes. That's a good point. Yeah. That's good. Because I didn't understand why would MMM be popular in mainland China, right? Like, then I was like, oh yeah, they like the beat. They like the beat. They don't necessarily understand the lyrics. They don't understand what he's saying. Okay.
And before we continue, I wanted to briefly summarize the hip-hop history we've gone through so far. So I know some of you might wonder why there's such a heavy emphasis on Taiwanese hip-hop history, and the reason is because it played such a pivotal role in the development of Chinese, and specifically Mandarin, hip-hop. As we mentioned, because of Taiwan's highly developed entertainment industry, Taiwan became a cultural center of sorts for the entirety of the Mandarin-speaking world, while Hong Kong played a similar role for the Cantonese-speaking community. So, essentially, liberalization in Taiwan's media in the late 1980s enabled things like MTV to get into Taiwan and directly expose the Taiwanese masses to the latest Western cultural trends, or at the very least, the commodified versions of the trends. And during this time, you have Chinese Americans like the LA Boys or Luo Baiji creating music in Taiwan, which sort of began the localization process of this music. And at around the turn of the century, you have a new wave of local Taiwanese artists like MC Hot Dog and Dwaki getting signed to smaller record labels that were willing to experiment with different styles of music. And we've spoken a bit about MC Hot Dog, but we haven't really talked about Dwaki, who represented another trend in Taiwanese hip-hop. Namely, his defining characteristic at the time was rapping mostly in Taiwanese Hokkien as opposed to Mandarin. And whereas much of Taiwan's music industry was centered in Taipei, Dwaki was unapologetically proud of his roots in southern Taiwan's Tainan City, also my mom's hometown. So he kind of did the hip-hop thing of putting her hometown on the map. And even though MC Hot Dog had made a name for himself in the underground by then, like, you know, around the 2001, 2002, his releases had all been EPs. So the honor of the first full-length hip-hop album by somebody born and raised in Taiwan actually went to Dwaki, who released his debut album, Shou Cai Lian Hua, in 2002. Now, I don't know if this album has an official English title, but Shou Cai Lian Hua is a Chinese idiom that literally means, you know, the tongue sparks the lotus, which describes, you know, one's talent to speak articulately and beautifully, unlike me. And around this time, other hip-hop groups formed, like, you know, the Tri Poets in 2002, and also the New York-based Asian Power. And Jeffrey Huang of the LA Boys that we mentioned earlier started a new hip-hop group in 2003 called Machi. So anyways, hip-hop was at a point where it was still mostly underground with, you know, tips of the iceberg somewhat in the lower echelons of the mainstream. So while these things were happening, in 2007, MC Hot Dog's 2006 album Wake Up won Best Mandarin Album at the Golden Melody Awards, which is kind of like the Grammys of the Chinese-speaking world. And that further pushed hip-hop into the mainstream, though it was still mostly underground, and the mainstream parts of it were still, you know, somewhat in the shadows in comparison to the biggest pop stars. So, if 2017 is the year that Chinese hip-hop really exploded in the mainstream thanks to the TV show Rap in China, then I would say by 2007, Chinese hip-hop had solidified its role in the mainstream as a supporting actor. But the influence was quite apparent, with quite a few mainstream musicians incorporating rap into their music. It wasn't necessarily hip-hop, but it was certainly hip-hop inspired. And most notably, artists like Jay Cho, Zhou Jielun. And Li Hong, Wang Li Hong. Integrated elements of hip-hop into their pop songs, oftentimes alongside other influences like traditional Chinese music. And while all this was happening, the underground hip-hop scene in Taiwan really started exploding with the formation of groups like Wan Tong, MG116. And the release of Tri Poet's first album, 押韵的开始, or The Beginning of Rhyme. And also notably, one of the biggest hip-hop labels, which is actually still an independent and small label in Taiwan, Yanshe, or Kao, was founded in 2005 by De La Pang, or De La Fat, and featured the now famous soft lipa Dan Bao on its roster. Now, in 2002, shortly after Dwaki released his groundbreaking album, Magic Stone Records, you know, the record company that he and MC Hot Dog were signed to, exited the music scene. And after MC Hot Dog completed his compulsory military service, he ended up with True Color Records, which was an imprint under one of Taiwan's biggest record companies, Rock Records. Dwaki, on the other hand, became more political, you know, supporting the DPP, writing songs that he released on the internet criticizing the KMT, which was the opposition party during Chen Shui-bian's leadership. And the thing is, because much of the money to be made in the music industry was not in Taiwan, but on the Chinese mainland instead, Dwaki had trouble finding a company that would sign him, because you can't be that anti-China and expect commercial success on the mainland. And you probably not make it past the censors there anyways. So he continued his brand of writing, you know, liberal political songs that he released online, and then he founded his own independent label called Kung Fu Entertainment, Ren Ren You Gong Lian. And for a while, he supported himself by offering rap lessons to people who wanted to learn how to rap. So as we can see, hip-hop was growing, but you were either MC Hot Dog or you were underground. And then another trend that started that we'll get into a bit more later in this episode was the formation of hip-hop clubs at universities, starting with National Taiwan University's NTU Hip-Hop, which was co-founded by a member of Tri-Poets, actually, Lin Laoshi. And actually, today there are quite a few rappers from this background, and one of them, Xiongzai, has entered the mainstream music industry after releasing his debut album with Dwaki's label, you know, Kung Fu Entertainment. Feels kind of strange talking about all these people that Lin Wei and I know.
Yeah. So in that time, either local or foreign rap music appearing fond of the image of hip-hop culture to Taiwanese as degrading women and decontextualized curses. So after this period of time, the preceding age awaiting was exploding digital downloads after 2000s. The record selling dropped dramatically. The cultural industry soon integrated the underground promoting mode. So the underground promoting mode was like those underground rappers that they write lyrics that are very different from the popular culture or the mainstream scenarios. And the main profits they are getting is not from selling their albums or selling their songs. The main profit they get is mainly from their performance or they're selling tickets, not selling albums. So after 2000s, we're heading to the digital download era. The cultural industry started to learn the promoting mode from the underground hip hop. Yeah, so after this process, the operation mode transformed into not focusing on the records, but forging the special image and fame of the center with new media and selling live performing tickets and other products. The internet and social media caused a short era of horizontal promoting. So it's like underground rappers or underground artists, they are promoting themselves with the corporations at the same time, so in the same social media or something, and which contribute to the young rappers and several independent record companies in the late 2000 and early 2010. For example, several newly independent music companies advanced to the Golden Melody Award and Golden Indie Music Award.
Like Yanse.
Yeah. And their ticket selling exceed most of new plus center. On the other hand, the cultural industry gradually assimilates former underground actors with the name like Johnny Wu, Johnny G, and T.E.N. and Rezer. That those artists started to appear in pop albums producer list.
So for some context, you know, these are some very big names nowadays. You know, some of them have their own production companies and whatnot. And for example, Razor, T Dao, his background is because his father is in the music industry. So even though he was into hip hop as a young kid and he was like selling beats for like $100 like when he was in his 20s. So in the pop industry, what happens is a lot of times they'll kind of basically have the melody and stuff written, but then they need someone to carry it out. So then people like him would be kind of, they would kind of outsource that stuff to people like him. But then over time, certain people like him would make a name for themselves and then have their own, you know, production companies and whatnot. And now he's like a pretty big producer in Taiwan's hip hop and pop industries, even though I see him more as pop than hip hop. This is not to denigrate him or to say deny his talent, but it's just from what he produces. That's just how I would personally categorize him. But this is just some context. These are people who are just like kind of within our social circles.
But what I was trying to say was that this means that the industry is evolving itself by absorbing the latest local cultivated skilled workers and expanding the market. This industry, in the industrial evolution, soon degenerated, and more specifically, gentrified the image of hip-hop community after 2010, not only because of most dominant actors focusing on a commercialization and commodification, but also because of the long-term conflicts inside the community. That's the difference in the social class defined how one performs foreign culture. The difference in the social class defined how one performs foreign cultures, such as hip hop. There was a scholar named Schwieg, S-C-H-W-I-G. She did a lot of research of Taiwan's hip hop communities, and she points out that hip hop actors in Taiwan are mostly urban middle class males. And the distinction of classes and the narratives representing their social relations stay undefined. So before the section, I would like to borrow the concept of class, which represent the relation between the individual and the means of production. Every group of class distinguishes different styles and consuming tendency fitting their social and cultural capitals. We must consider the context of Taiwan's history and society to acknowledge the condition of the situation of classes. After the Second World War, being the front line of the United States confronting China and the USSR, multiple resources and cultural products fluxed into Taiwan through various medias, such as the radio station we mentioned before. For this situation, we were facing the problems of reconstructing after the Second World War. Any products and person from developed countries, such as the United States, would easily be labeled with advanced. So as I was a kid, most people in Taiwan would think that if you come back from the United States, you are like higher level people. So even the McDonald's started selling hamburgers while I was a kid. McDonald's was kind of high class restaurant when I was a kid. Yeah. And
this is just not limited to Taiwan, by the way. It's all across East Asia. It's same thing in mainland China. When McDonald's was first opened in Beijing in the late 80s, it was also like it got mobbed by people. And because they charge higher than local prices, so people treat it as like, oh, that's kind of the upper class food it becomes a status symbol, right? Take somebody to McDonald's for a date. It's outrageous. go ahead.
The different scales of social conflicts after this liberation, after Japanese rule, enforced the government of the ROC, relying on the ISA for maintaining legitimacy. They benefit the government employees, which was mostly consist of the immigrants from the 1949, and weakened the local capitalist with Chinese cultural and educational standard and policies such as land reforming. This policy would also stroke most local Taiwanese and reform the hierarchy of social class into the dominant 1949 immigrants higher than local capitalists and higher than local Taiwanese people. And this situation had maintained relying on martial law until the industrialization era in the 1970s. And this process led the flow of social classes and cultivated numerous middle-class people in the 1970s. But while Taiwan's society stepped into the 1990s, facing industrial transformation and slow development of the economy, the stagnation of capital accumulation caused anxiety of the whole society. Most parents expect that higher education of their kids would break this trap, which was partially influenced by the Chinese tradition values of studying and exams. With this social pressure, the government commenced to adjust the policy of education, especially in higher education, and to increase expenditure in basic education. The number of people graduating from college and university rose four times during the 90s to early 2000s. And that makes a lot of young people in Taiwan get into higher education. And before the 1990s, only few pioneer hip-hoppers with certain condition of economy and cultural capitals received and understood the cultural products and image from the Western media. This situation changed during the 90s, not only because of the expanding era of cultural imperialism, but also due to the rising amount of higher education students. This social background explain what the scholars talk about Taiwan's hip-hop community. And those youngsters with enough economic and cultural capitals to absorb the foreign cultural products of hip-hop.
That's important because 1990s is when also Taiwan was entering into a kind of post-industrial economy. Yeah. When the economy transitioned from an industrial economy of manufacturing to a mostly service-based economy, right? Like before yeah. Taiwan was about factories, but once the factory all moved to mainland, the economy itself transitioned to service-oriented economy where knowledge-based economy become important. It becomes even more important to acquire a college degree, whereas before you just need a high school degree and you go to the factories and work in the factories. But now to function in a knowledge-based economy, you actually need to acquire that additional higher education. And also Taiwan itself went from a developing country to a developed country. Because in early 90s, when I first came to the United States, I would still remember jokes about, you know, made in Taiwan as some like shoddy goods, right? Like I remember there was a movie or TV with George Clooney, and the umbrella he tried to open was like couldn't open, and he's like, made in Taiwan, and I just like like totally unnecessary remark that was inserted into the movie, because it's made in Taiwan. This was like early 90s, right? But of course, That doesn't happen anymore because nothing gets made in Taiwan anymore because the industry get offsourced to mainland China. Now, later, the joke become about made in China products. So Taiwan itself is getting wealthier. More people are entering into the middle class, becoming better educated and entering middle class. And there is additional wealth to support that more cultural capital. I guess that's what you're trying to say. Yeah.
Yeah. And this social background also explains why the lyrics or the Taiwan's hip hop community are always talking about the lives or the situation they are facing in the urban area or in their social condition. In the early 2000s, a lot of college students started to organize some organization in
or school clubs at universities. Hip-hop clubs.
So, and started to do some research about how to write hip hop lyrics or rap song lyrics or other cultural products that comes from hip hop culture.
Like, I've been to those. Can I add something real quick just to get the audience a better picture of what that's like? So you know how you have like clubs and colleges, like, you know, you might have a chess club, you might have like a dance club. Well, these hip-hop clubs, a lot of them are like pretty nerdy kids like me. Like, you go there and then they'll like sit down and they'll listen to a bunch of like hip-hop, and then they'll be like, okay, so you know what this rapper did here, you know what this type of flow is called, like for example, like the syncopation over here and the triplets over here. Like, it'll break it down scientifically and then be like, oh, look at this rhyme scheme. See, over here, like, his rhymes, it's not just the last syllable. It's like six syllables in a row. And then, like, to make this rhyme stand out even more, it's not just the six syllables that rhyme, but they also have the same flow scheme. So then it, yeah. Like, that's what it's like. You take something like hip-hop and you turn it into something, like chess club energy. That's what it was like.
Yeah, that's what happened when I was in. That's what happened when I was in the hip hop clubs when I was a college student, and yeah, I was one of those nerds. That situation also explained why the rap lyrics in the 21st century became so boring, I guess.
Yeah. I wouldn't say boring, it was just unusual, because if you listen to Western, like, hip-hop from the U.S., you hear about, like, I mean, you had that boring stuff, too, but you also hear about, like, life on the streets, you know, like, whether it's, there's some embellishment here and there, but you get to, like, understand, oh, like, this is what police brutality is like, they'll rap about that sort of stuff, but then, like, MC Hot Dog's, like, early albums, like, before he was famous, would just talk about, oh, how, he doesn't know what he's gonna do in his life, and his parents are complaining about how he's just kind of fucking around, and how, and they just want him to get a job and go do his military service, get a job. But
yeah, but there are also other kind of Taiwanese hip hop, such as 混血儿. The artist from this company, they're trying to deliver the different image of Taiwanese hip hop.
So what we're seeing is, in the beginning, it was like the people with moral and cultural capital. So the early pioneers, you had people like the LA Boys and those returning ABCs, and then their friends, and then their college students and whatnot on the internet, just linking up with each other, experimenting, and with some getting signed and getting record deals and getting some mainstream exposure. And then after that, this sort of stuff starts permeating to the rest of Taiwanese society, to different classes, to different backgrounds. And then from then on, you're starting to hear a lot of more variety of just styles and topics. But at the same time, the entirety of Taiwanese society is also being more exposed to U.S. mainstream pop culture. So then this sort of, they can kind of just go straight to the source more so now than they could in the early 2000s or the 90s. And it's contributing to part of why you're seeing like such an explosion today, especially with the rise of shows like Rap in China, which began in, I believe, 2017. And as Lin Wei was saying earlier, with different social classes now creating hip-hop, there tends to be different interpretations among rappers, producers, listeners, etc. on how hip-hop should be performed. The group in that video we just showed, 911 or 911, is a great example of what happens when imperialism disseminates cultural commodities from the imperial core to the rest of the world. So, as you can see, hip-hop was initially brought to Taiwan through channels such as MTV and returning members of the diaspora, which was then adopted by people in the middle classes, who were more likely to be in closer contact with the latest trends in the West. Then from there, the culture became more accessible to the rest of society, trickling down to social classes that typically don't have as much affinity to the West. Whereas in the past, you had a small group of people from the middle classes who could kind of tell everyone what was and wasn't real hip-hop, now you have a bunch of people who really couldn't care less about that sort of dogma, who take inspiration from the stuff they hear and incorporate what they like into their own interpretations of this art form. So, while this was really just cultural development, for a while it wasn't uncommon to see certain people among early pioneers and their followers who deride these developments. I remember in the early 2010s, when MJ116 was big in the underground and getting ready to cross over into the mainstream, they, their fans, and other artists like them were often criticized by some of the people Lin Wei and I knew, including some people in the hip-hop clubs, of having a superficial understanding of hip-hop. And then the people on the other side of the argument would in turn criticize the people making those criticisms of being elitists, dogmatists, and gatekeepers of a culture that was meant to be accessible by the broader masses to begin with. Here's a short clip from one of MJ116 member Iso's mixtapes. If you're listening to the audio version of this podcast, I highly recommend going on YouTube and watching the video version so you have subtitles.
我没读什么书，我可能不会老舍。老大不想无法加入台大实验室，我只来自王，所以到处书籍。我没有别的意思，只是想要做我自己。 So I want to ask a question. When did that rap battle between mainland China and Taiwan started?
2007.
Was that 2007? Can you guys talk about that a little bit, how it started?
So there was, so this is kind of proof that there was hip hop in the Chinese mainland, but just because of a variety of reasons, it wasn't very mainstream until like 10 years later. But 2006 or 2007, there was a mainland Chinese basketball player from Jiangsu who elbowed a Taiwanese basketball player in a basketball match.
So mm-hmm. Taiwanese people were upset about him. So then one of their pioneers we mentioned earlier, Dua Ki, made a rap song dissing Meng Da, saying, just typical hip hop, like talking shit. So then after that happened, there was this one mainland Chinese rapper named Tian Jin Fan. Tian Jin Fan's response was pretty bad in the sense that he wasn't on beat, but his lyrics were kind of hilarious. So then Dua Ki responded to that, like basically saying like, fuck China, fuck Tianjin Fan, and fuck you if you're also saying fuck Taiwan. And then he also had lyrics saying like, oh, Taiwanese people are not Chinese people, we're not descendants of the dragon. Just more talking shit. So then that got more of a response from the mainland. So then there was this one guy named MC Guang Guang from Nanjing who talked about how Dua Ki and Chen Shui-bian are like having sex with each other and stuff like that. Yeah, it was a lot of back and forth, and then just a lot of mainland rappers just hopping on the bandwagon, and also a lot of Taiwanese rappers jumping on the bandwagon, dissing those rappers, so.
That sounds like fun.
It was a very fun time.
Yeah. Yeah, but for, like you said, for various reasons, rap itself didn't really gain mainstream acceptance in China. I think For one thing, there wasn't any big, music industry group kind of promoting that genre of music. At the time, the hip-hop influenced music have already made its way to China because a lot, Taiwanese music were super popular in China, in mainland China in the 80s, 90s, and early 2000s. So by 2000, a lot of the Taiwanese singers, now they go to make music for the mainland Chinese market, and in doing so, you know, they keep some of these rap influenced music in their music. I think that's how most of the people on mainland get first exposed to rap. I mean, in Chinese language.
Jay Chou.
Yes, mm-hmm. Jay Chou. That's exactly who I'm thinking about. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But then
they'll hear that, and then some people will want to dig and then listen to some more, like, you know, foreign hip hop, and then at some point they'll also be exposed to like MC Hot Dog. MC Hot Dog was very popular in the mainland even before hip hop was popular. Like, there were like whole websites dedicated to him, like Hago Bang Zhong Lin Wang.
Yeah. So okay. So can we get to the China has hip hop now? do we still have something to transition over?
Yeah. So 2017 was the year when there was a new it's kind of like an American Idol-esque show from mainland China called Rap in China or 中国有嘻哈. Which later was renamed 中国新说唱, but the English name remained Rap in China, I believe. It just blew up. Like, everyone was just talking about it, talking about how who beat who in a battle, whose song was, like, really awesome. In mainland China and in Taiwan, everyone was just talking about it, and Chinese hip-hop was never that popular. Obviously, it existed, because otherwise, where did they get the rappers from? But then, all of a sudden, it wasn't just, like, something that people who were into hip-hop knew about. Now, it's just, like, any kid on the street will hear about, oh, I know guy. I know Vava. PG1. Bridge. Yeah,
切了一切都得靠你自己我外婆都告诉我说这一条真理因为 Daddy Mommy 出了生命没东西
Higher Brothers
我希望你们不要犯过不能不不累不要犯过不能自知的你不要犯过却要说谎不要犯过我只想要独自一人给我生活阻止一生 Maria Carey Coco 李维女人来欢呼阻止逼着
One of the judges was MC Hot Dog
Yeah, for one thing, it's finally a popular show on primetime television, right? Mm-hmm. And that's, I think that's really spread its audience. And I mean, that it only happened 3 years ago. It's crazy to think about, 2017. That's not that long ago. But yeah, it's just, the rap really exploded in popularity since then. Because a lot of more exposure.
Mm-hmm. And it can kind of tell who's new to hip hop and who's not because, for example, some of my music got re-uploaded to Bilibili, and I've seen every now and then I see comments saying, "I never knew people could rap about politics." So then when people say that, it tells me, oh, they're new to this, which is why it's not bad that there are those kind of mainstream shows with commodified hip hop, because what happens is it introduces more people to the sound. And then once certain people like it, they'll start digging and they'll find other things they like. You
know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, this is kind of the theme of our talk, right? The journey of hip hop from the American street culture, the urban culture, the black culture, being commodified by the big corporations and packaged it. And then that gets carried over to rest of the world by American hegemony. I mean, literally by American GIs, right? By American soldiers get carried around. And then that gets spread around, but then get adopted locally by at the grassroots level by kids who try to imitate the style. Mm-hmm. They thought it's cool because first of all, it has that kind of status associated with being from the West, being mm-hmm. from the U.S. And then the cool factor just increased by 10 when you're outside of U.S. And then they start to create their own music, adopt it, trying to reinterpret their own experience through rap music. But then they get rediscovered by the local music industry, kind of a replay of what happened inside United States mm-hmm. when the big record label capitalize on a popular street culture and commodify it. And that happened in Taiwan, in mainland China, a second time when a marginal underground cutting edge music and then get quote unquote rediscovered and repackaged and been sold, as cultural commodity again to broader masses for profit. Right, this is like the story of hip hop. I'm just a student. I'm the fly on the wall. So I really wanted to give the mic to you guys. Have you guys talk about your experience and what you witnessed and what you find interesting in the evolution of hip hop in Taiwan?
I think one thing is in the early 2010s, before hip hop became really mainstream, it was like a group of people, and they felt like they were some sort of elites, right? They kind of just got to dictate what was and wasn't hip-hop. Like, there was this very big hip-hop website in Taiwan. It was just middle-class dudes in their 20s and 30s just talking about, promoting who they want in Taiwan, but also introducing the foreign music that they like. So then when, new songs by, their favorite rappers, T.I., Lil Wayne, Eminem, Common, Talib Kweli came out, they would just write about them and then introduce them almost like a infomercial, like on TV, like, hey, this is what happens in this song, this is why it's awesome, and people who want to be seen as more hip-hop will follow that and be like, oh yeah, this stuff is really awesome because these people said so. But as more and more people started being exposed to hip-hop through other channels, some of those older people just started getting visibly upset that they've lost kind of the control. It was kind of like their subculture. They were kind of gatekeeping, and now it's out of their control, and they're kind of upset. And I've gotten into certain just back and forths with people over this stuff, just kind of because they're older and I'm younger. And
why why don't you guys talk a little bit about how you personally got into hip hop? I think, you know, people that might be more interesting to the audience.
Well, we've talked about it before, so I think we should hand the mic to Lin Wei and have him kind of share his, because yeah, his story is pretty interesting.
The experience is quite different to me because I was born and raised in Keelung City. Then there are a lot of pioneers in Keelung City who practiced hip hop dance before our generation. And in the situation of the Keelung City, we are like a harbor city. And in the era when I was a kid, that we don't have that industrial growth in the 90s. So Keelung City was degrading and become a city of criminal.
Oh, because Keelung is the location. Keelung is near Taipei, right? It was a harbor. Yeah. Harbor city near Taipei. So it used to be a very industrial city because that was one of the harbor where goods get imported and exported from Taiwan, right? And then, you know, the made in Taiwan product left your city and came to the supermarket of United States, and where George Clooney complains about. But then in the 90s, what happened was, we talked about earlier, this deindustrialization process where the capitalists moved their factory to mainland China in pursuit of even cheaper labor. So I guess what happened to Keelung is, it's kind of not that dissimilar to what happened to United States itself. You know, I in 2000, I worked on a project in Kansas City, like in the heartland of US. And I can tell you, man, it's like what used to be the very busy city center of Kansas City, the area where all the former factories are, it looked like a bombed out, like it looks like a place out of World War II, you know, like a total. but there was no war. It's just like all the factory got shut down and moved, you know.
There's any shopping mall in suburbia nowadays.
Yeah, like so Kansas City became like, it's interesting because there are two Kansas Cities. There's a Kansas City on the Missouri side, which is a larger part of Kansas City, and the Kansas City on the Kansas side. So Kansas side of the Kansas City is a nicer part of town, where with the suburbs and all the rich white people go shopping and you know, go to restaurant and stuff. but the east side of Kansas City on Missouri side, where that was the industrial part of the Kansas City. It looks like a ghost town, man. It was like a bomb out, whole bomb out World War II ruin. And I was there because I was there in 2000. There was a first tech boom. So there's some, because there's so many empty buildings, so a lot of the tech companies were moving in because it's so cheap. It's cheap to rent those buildings and set up their headquarters. But it was weird, man. It was just like, what the hell happened here? So I can't imagine, you know, the place that you grew up in, Keelung in Taiwan, after the deindustrialization process.
It wasn't necessarily empty, but there was like the better off kids ended up going to Taipei for school, and then the people left behind were just a little bit more underprivileged. And it's kind of sad, like, because, you know, the city had such a prosperous past, and nowadays it's just overrun by, well, it's not necessarily overrun, but there are compared to the rest of Taiwan, like, suicide rates higher, drug use is higher, there's like more, there's like a lot of like just social ills.
Yeah
it's just symptoms of like a very unhealthy society.
Yeah, so when I was a kid, that the hip-hop dancer pioneers around our community was trying to organize some kind of groups to help or educate our generation to not get involved into some drug selling or gangster scenario. And they were trying to teach us how to dance or something like that. And so a lot of my classmates started to practice hip-hop dance when we was in junior high school, but I was not one of them because I'm not really good at using my body. So, but I was influenced by them. I started to listen to hip hop music, and and started to try to produce a hip hop beat and to write some lyrics to express my feelings. And
如果我的手是用来被打不是写字，那么我要怎么写出美丽的诗？如果我的嘴是用来背诵敌人的历史，那么我要怎么讲出来被压迫的事实？
And that is how I get into this kind of culture, but it's just the beginning of my journey. And I really get into the hip hop community when I was in college. When I was in college, because I knew some people that started in National Taiwan University, and they are running the hip hop club in that university. And I knew them when I was high school. I went to Taipei for high school, so I knew them since I was started in Taipei. And I asked them if I could join them to run the hip hop clubs. And hip hop was not so popular in that time, so they accept me, and we were trying to produce some hip hop songs and to help some activities together when we was in college. And that's my story to get into the hip hop community of Taiwan. Lots of my rap songs, we're talking about the situation in Keelung City, or the community, the poor situation in Taiwan. But also, some of my soul was trying to express something weird. Yeah, as we mentioned before, when I was in college, a lot of people in hip hop clubs, we were so nerd to chop every rap song sentence and to produce some hip hop song with something like formula or mathematics, and I was trying to make some different songs than this kind of song. So I was trying to write really weird lyrics, like
穷到爆.
Yeah,
you know the song Paris by Kanye West and Jay-Z?
No.
Like he took that beat and then made it about just like poverty in Taiwan.
Oh, that's like, interesting.
什么地堡地瓜叶都吃不饱，日以继夜工作，却连三餐也难以温饱。夜店没 with your hands， 要不要跟我回家睡
？Fuck you, man！ 你是谁？
我家没床垫。
That she could.
Yeah. But now you are involved in coaching the next generation, right? Into induct them into the hip hop culture, right?
Yeah. After graduation, I started to organize. Yeah, it's like continue our pioneers, you know, in Keelung. we are continue our organization to educate the next generation, to practice dances or other kind of hip hop art form, like something to protect them from the crime scene. So our organization is trying to do the things that our pioneers taught us before, and this is what I do now. So yeah,
awesome.
And that's great. I met him at the hip hop club.
Yeah.
What were you doing at the hip hop club?
Well, I mean, I think we mentioned this before in your first episode, the appearance. So I'm not gonna get too much into detail, but I started rapping when I was 17, just, you know, making my own mixtapes. One of my first songs was so bad it became viral. So then I was like Rebecca Black. So then after that, it was just me trying to prove myself. So then after like a few months, you know, after I made more stuff, people were saying, wow, like this guy really improved in such a short amount of time. And then when I graduated from high school, I visited Taiwan. And that was around the time when a lot of just other pretty big names in the underground were reaching out to me saying, hey, keep up the good work. And inevitably, some of them were also just the people in the hip hop clubs in Taiwan. And then when I discovered, hey, there's, you know, it's not just one or two hip hop clubs at like one or two universities. It was like a network and they were all like connected. There was like this Facebook group where everyone was like, you know, in connection with one another. And I don't know, I felt appreciated. Because, like, I had an audience and, you know, we were giving each other constructive criticism. And, yeah, that's kind of how I met him. It was, I think the first time I met him in person was at a hip-hop competition, actually, in Taipei in 2011. Yeah, Matt Street.
Matt Street. 2010 or 11.
11.
我不跟你们下，我就是不一样，我不跟你们下，赶快去验个话。
You know, we didn't really get to know each other too well, but eventually, as we got more political and I got more political, we just started. Oh, he was one of the few people who would put up with my bullshit. Let's put it that way. But then we got to know each other better, and we started like doing other things, like study, like, you know, Marxism-Leninism together, and so. Yeah. Another thing is around that time, like 2011. That was when, do you know Wan Tong, MJ116?
Mm-hmm. You asking me or you asking me?
Asking you, I know Lin Wei knows.
No, I have no idea, man. I'm a novice. I'm a noob.
Right now, they're like one of the most, they're one of the few mainstream hip-hop groups. And back then, they were underground. And they were really easily accessible. What they ended up doing was they had these get-togethers with their fans, like barbecues and whatnot. And it was actually quite genius the way they did it, because it's like, you know, they formed this sort of bond with their audience, who are like, you know, high schoolers and college students. And then as they got more successful, these kids were also growing up. So then there was this feeling of, hey, everyone's growing up together.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was back then. Like, this was how underground things were. Like now, like in America, you know, it's not that easy for you to just meet your favorite rappers. But back, even now, like, it's not too hard to meet your favorite rappers in Taiwan. Like, I know in the Chinese mainland, meeting MC Hot Dog is a really huge deal if you like his music. But in Taiwan, it's actually pretty damn easy to meet him. You just got to be at the right place at the right time.
Yeah.
Yeah. So anything else you want to discuss, for example, like how...
Yeah, my question for you guys. Is there anything else you guys want to cover that you feel should be covered?
Not that I can think of. I'm like really tired, so I'm not at my full capacity to think. But
okay.
Yeah, I think we did a good job summarizing the development of hip-hop through its evolution history. So should I do an ending the show?
Yeah.
Well, that was a very interesting talk on the history and evolution of hip-hop culture from the street culture of USA, from the black urban culture to the youth culture of Taiwan and mainland China. And I thank you, Lin Wei and Xiangyu, for coming to the show and talk about it and share your own personal experience. And I hope my audience have learned something from it. But most importantly, I hope you were entertained. So thank you for listening.
Thanks for having us on.
Yes, always. And thank you guys out there for listening. Until next time. Bye bye. 你们制造自由的幻影，从此没人能唤醒，只有跪舔糖果体制才能换烧饼。我们都是正邪，我们认知正邪，我们手提圣贤的真言却换不到真钱。我们真心换绝情，我们投入幻觉里，我们吸食自由的鸦片却被判决刑期。我们都是镰刀和锤子，要让未清醒的人们看见社会正在垂死。我们都是劳工啊，随时记得看不见却绑在每个劳工身上的链子。